I'm Stephanie, and I'm the curator of the exhibition out there. If you haven't had a chance to look at it yet, when we get done, please go out and spend some time with it. For me, it was about coming in with an exhibition that already existed, which isn't the normal thing that a curator does, but for me, it was a unique challenge to look at the information contained within this already existing exhibition and figure out where the inaccuracies were, and to find ways to highlight those inaccuracies and also to rectify those things. And a lot of that was with help from David. And the reason that David is so important to this exhibition, and also just generally to the work that I did and the work that I do, is that we're trying to continue Indigenous knowledge and also work to correct the history that has been sort of perpetuated, unfortunately, through colonialism. And as Nat mentioned, David contributed feedback to the previous iteration of this exhibition. And when I first started working with the museum, I actually received a copy of a letter that David wrote in 2004 that was giving feedback on the sort of preliminary designs of this exhibition. And some of the things that David noted were things that I immediately noticed as well. And some of those things being a lack of information about the industrial school programs that took children from their families and basically forced them to assimilate to white culture. It doesn't really talk at all about termination or the removal of Indigenous people from their lands, something that is sometimes referred to as the Oregon Trail of Tears. So there are these things that are just totally missing or sort of breezed over, I guess, because there was priority given to other types of information in the exhibit before. And so for me, it was important to take the feedback that David had already given almost 15 years ago now in this letter and try to rectify some of that as a way to, one, show that yes, there is a difference in perspective, and that also even science is still kind of catching up with itself and its presuppositions about Indigenous culture and how long we've existed here on this continent. So I thought that was a really good way to bring this whole thing full circle, was to go back to the original Indigenous voice they had consulted and not necessarily incorporated as fully as they could. So with that, this is for me all about giving David space to share this information, these things that have been hidden, not only from the exhibition, but also that were just hidden generally from people through the sort of exaltation of the Oregon Trail and the idea of Western expansion and this idealization of those things without really acknowledging what happened to the people who are living here already. And so I think that there are a lot of lessons to be learned in that history that can be applied to our current political climate today. And I think that learning to empathize not only with the people that this has affected in the past, but also learning that this continues to carry on through intergenerational trauma, and that this isn't just in the past. And that was a big part of what David talked about in his letter, was that this exhibition is all about history. It's not actually about what happened to the Indigenous people once all of these things occurred. And so that's also a part of this talk today, is to sort of remember that this isn't in the past and that it continues on in the generations who have since come after it. So with that, I will turn it over to David, and also just say thanks to everyone who showed up today. I really appreciate y'all being here.
Well, thank you. So it's been talked about as being sort of the Trail of Tears. I think that term came up with, was created really for Oregon, at least, by Stephen Dove Beckham. He wrote a piece in one of these Southern Oregon journals, and called it sort of the Oregon Trail of Tears. And it was in reference to the removal from Table Rock to Grand Ronde. Since that time, I've done some work and found that that was not the first removal. The first big removal was from the Umpqua Reservation, which happened literally a month earlier. And I think he's now publishing on that. I put something on my blog about that. I have a big blog site that has stuff like that on it. There's also removals on the coast after the Iranian War. There are removals from the valley, removals from the Columbia to Grand Ronde. There are other removals in Oregon from the Columbia to Warm Springs, removals to the Umatilla Reservation, removals to the Malheur Reservation, which no longer exists, other removals to Klamath, which went on for many years. And so there are all kinds of these removals. They could all be termed as trails of tears. I think the trail of tears, I know it's an enigmatic sort of statement and title. I don't like it. It kind of avoids the harshness of that situation, doesn't it? It makes it kind of seem like poetry. It's not poetry. It's, you are literally removing these people from their lands forever and taking away all they know and literally impoverishing them and placing them on a reservation where they have nothing and they are completely under the control of the U.S. government, which is not a good thing to be, right? I mean, for a good example, I mean, what about the immigrants today that are in concentration camps in the United States? I mean, I would not want to be an immigrant today in a concentration camp because I've heard of the conditions, it doesn't sound good, and that's not much different from what we're hearing when I'm researching for the tribes. You know, they're placed literally in these canvas tents in the wintertime in Oregon, which is not a good thing to be in Oregon at any time. You know, seriously. back in the 19th century, it was a much harsher time period, harsher period than today. We have a kind of a milder climate. It's actually warmer today than it used to be, hence climate change, right? So back then, it was much harsher, much colder conditions. I mean, I talk about folks about this all the time. I mean, the Columbia River would literally freeze over every winter, where people could, you know, drive their cart across the river in the wintertime, you know, horses and all, because it was frozen over that solid. I mean, when has that happened recently? I can't remember it. I heard it happen sometime in the 60s. I mean, I mean that's how much we are into global warming. We have not heard about that for perhaps generations now. So that situation is much harsher than this idea of Trail of Tears, which, you know, I understand it's a powerful concept, but still, mm-hmm. It's really, really kind of borrowing that from the Cherokee removals and stuff. So anyway, so I'll launch into this. Let's talk about a few things here. Okay, so there were 7 treaties that ratified Western Oregon. A lot of, in the news today, there's this idea of the treaty tribes on the Columbia. And that's a direct reference to, I don't think it's gonna get any better. There's bad pictures. So that's in direct reference to the tribes on the Columbia that have fishing rights on the Columbia. So that's what that means. That doesn't mean that other tribes don't have treaties and treaty rights. But that's what it means on the Columbia, and that's a different situation where there's like this conflict now between who has fishing rights in Columbia and who does not, okay? And that's what they're trying to say. But back in the 1850s, there were at least 2 different treaty processes. 1851 was the first one that sort of failed. There was 19 treaties written from the Willamette Valley, from the Columbia, and from Southern Oregon. When they went back to, when Anson Dart took those treaties back to Washington, D.C., he basically harpooned them. He basically destroyed them because he said, well, if we allow these treaties to go forward, even though he was somewhat in charge of them, we would have to buy land from settlers who had already claimed that land, because the tribes absolutely wanted to stay in Western Oregon. They wanted to keep their little plots of land. And so that's untenable. We're not going to be able to buy, it's just too expensive to buy all that land from the settlers. So we have to basically not ratify them. So he actually the man in charge of the treaties gave the argument to Congress to not ratify the treaties. So, and I think he wanted to move up in politics, but I don't think he ever did. Mainly because of that, probably. But I actually found these treaties in the archives, the National Archives. An archivist said, "Hey, here's a file." And so, that's a picture from my camera of one of those actual 1851 treaties, the one with the little seals on there. And they were not placed in a special file because they were never ratified, so they don't really have any that much importance, other than the fact that they seem to have more information about the tribes. If you read through them, and if you read through the whole transcripts of the treaty proceedings and the reports, you'll find that the tribes absolutely were involved in that process, that it wasn't just the leaders there when they were negotiating the treaties, that it was the whole tribe sitting around them, which is a totally different context, right? And so they were like, and then when they did the maps, which I'll show you a piece of the map, they literally had a map on a table, and they were having the Indian people point out where their lands were. So that brings a whole different connotation to that treaty proceedings than somebody else, than federal authorities just making that up, right? Okay. This treaty was the Umpqua and Kalapuya Treaty, which the other Kalapuya Treaty, other than the Willamette Valley Treaty, which has to do with Kalapuyas in the Umpqua Valley, which kind of shows, it's also a ratified treaty, which shows that Kalapuyas are not only in this valley, they're also in the Umpqua Valley too. So we had this sort of broader range of tribes. And so of the 9 treaties in Western Oregon that were negotiated, only 7 were ratified in the Palmer era. So Palmer took over after Anson Dart, and he came back, and he was an old hand at sort of politics around here, and so everybody sort of knew him, respected him. He'd been a general in the volunteer militia, so that's why he got the term General Palmer. And so he went around to the tribes and began to put out these sort of like conflicts the best he could in the South first, and then, you know, with the Umpquas and with the Rogue Rivers, and then he came into the Willamette Valley by 55, and he wrote the treaty for the Willamette Valley tribes, because there wasn't really any conflict in the valley here, besides the fact the tribes were a nuisance. By 1855, settlers literally owned all of the Willamette Valley. The tribes were on their lands, really at the sort of goodwill of the settlers, that they could remain, and probably because they were being used as laborers on the farms. So, but by that time, there was no way they could carry on their traditional culture, because much of the farming that had happened had sort of like plowed up all of their root crops. They were hunting out the game with rifles, fishing out the fish. So the traditional food sources of the tribes were gone or were heavily impacted. And so if you were normally supposed to, or go out to a camas field, you know, process a bunch of camas, bring it back for winter storage, you couldn't do that. Or you had to go further afield, or you had to find a new camas source. And that was just not happening. And so tribes are basically, you know, asking for handouts from their settlers. When that didn't happen, because settlers, for whatever reason, they didn't value the tribes enough to sort of give them handouts, even though they knew they could count on them for labor and for help developing their farms, which is a very strange. So they're very sort of like what I call them stingy farmers at the time. And so then you start to see this like thievery happening where the tribes are stealing cattle, stealing horses, slaughtering the animals. And I think there's a direct connection. You're taking away their food sources. You're taking away their land. They have smaller and smaller places to live. They can't, all the fences up mean you can travel over people's land and stuff freely. You're not feeding them enough. They don't have enough food to last the winter times. So they have to steal to survive. I think that's the direct connection. And by that time they began complaining to Palmer and saying, you know, these are just vermin. And that's what you see in the newspapers. You see these comments about the tribes as being rascals, scoundrels, savages, vermin. that we need to get rid of. And in the South, getting rid of them meant genocide. In the North, getting rid of them meant, you know, just moving them somewhere else. And it turned out to be, you know, first the Coast Reservation, and the second plan became, in late 55, the Grand Ronde Reservation. That was like a sudden plan, because with the Roger War raging in the South, and with another war sort of raging on the Columbia, they had to move everybody really quickly to save them from further settler violence. So this slide is kind of a transcript of the treaty proceedings from 51. And so it kind of represents some of those feelings I was talking about in terms of what the tribes are feeling about their land and how they want to remain and stuff. It says, like, the Great Fighter wished to part with all their lands except for a small portion which they wished to reserve to live upon, feed their horses and cattle, and cultivate. And that line itself suggests they're already transforming their culture into more of an agrarian settler culture. They wanted this land between the forks of the San Yam. These are the San Yam peoples. And their hearts are upon that land, and not wish to leave it. And we don't want any other piece of land as a reserve in the forks of the San Yam River. And they'd rather be shot than leave the land. So that's a pretty strong statement, suggesting that they really had, you know, these strong feelings about their land. They really wanted to remain. And this is 51. And somehow, by 55, when the next treaty came along, they were degraded enough that they agreed to leave. And I think that's, it's constant conflict, constant starvation, poverty at that point would force you probably to make a different make your mind differently. And this is an image from the Gibbs-Starling Treaty, which is kind of representing in three places the temporary reservations that they established in 51, which they wanted a permanent. And so we see, let me see if I can get out of the way here. So this is the San Yam Band of Malala Indians right here. They want a big piece of the Cascades and part of the valley. There's the San Yam Reservation right here for the Kalapuyas. So that's between the forks of the San Yam again. And then we have the Lucky Mute Reservation over here. It's hard to see on this really bad map, but an image, but that's what it was. So that would be in the Lucky Mute area. And so Independence would be up here, Monmouth up here, and Corvallis down here somewhere. So that was what was happening in the valley at that time. The tribes wanted to stay in their land because they saw a lot of value to that. They could feed themselves a little bit off that land. And really, I think if you read through some of the other statements, it talks about, like, we wanted to stay on the land where our people are buried. So the Lehigh Valley Treaty comes along in 55. Again, Palmer negotiates that. It's a pretty large treaty, probably one of the largest in Oregon, which has a good number of tribes involved. I think it's the largest number of tribes involved in one treaty in Oregon. All the Kalapuya tribes from the valley, including all these folks, Clackamas people, Cascades, Wallala, down the Columbia, Multnomah, Northern Malala, San Yam Malala probably. By this time, for some reason, the San Yam Malala don't exist. I think they integrated somehow with the Northern Malala. There's some indications they did that. And this whole area is at least 4 million acres, which is ceded to the U.S. government in exchange for a permanent reservation, services, some money, you know, and really the biggest thing was safety. They wanted safety from being attacked by Americans. So, and that was a big deal because there were constantly these attacks. So that map over there is called the Belden Map, 1855, and you see those red lines where the tribal territories were laid out. And one interesting territory that was never sort of fully paid for, because in the treaty, it only pays for lands in the Oregon Territory, which at that time was south of the Columbia. Before this time, it was north of the Columbia as well. Is the lands of the Cascades and, like, Multnomah peoples here. And this area right here, you see that? He goes into Washington State. Okay, and there's another version of this map, which I found recently from the National Archives, which shows a little more detail. It connects these lines and stuff. But this area right here was never paid for under any treaty. Even the other treaties with the Cowlitz and everybody else, it was never paid for. So the Clackamas people and Cascades people and Multnomahs were never paid for that land, which is something that I've been bringing up occasionally with the tribe, suggesting at some point they'll claim that and get paid for that in some way. So again, Oregon Trail of Tears, from the Rogue Rivers were from February to March, but the Umpqua, those from the Umpqua Reservation were from January to February, so they were previous to this. So the Rogue Rivers, Shastas, and Takelmas that were on the Table Rock or Rogue River Reservation over there, that's on the building map again, were walked overland, most likely on the Applegate Trail, up to at least Rickrayal. There's some indication that some of the tribes did not go through Rickrayal because there's a lot of sort of anti-Indian thoughts at that point. And because along the trail, they were attacked several times by settlers. And the army did really nothing about it. But there's some indication that one of the trails went through a valley just before you get to Rickrayal. I forget what it's called. So they went up that direction before you got to Rickrayal, and then went over the hill to Grand Ronde, up in that sort of wooded area. In that time period between January and May, the Molallas, the Kalapuyas, the Clackamas, and Cascades are also moved to Grand Ronde in smaller sort of removals from individual reservations. And so I in the last couple of years have uncovered this whole history of temporary reservations on in the Willamette Valley, and so we'll go forward with that. So there were a good number of temporary reservations, probably 10 or 11 of them in the valley. Palmer had to find a way to sort of move the tribes quickly out of the way of settlers. And so what he did is he assigned some farmers in the valley, probably his friends, as special agents, and they got like $1,000 for like 1 year to take care of a tribe of Indians. And a tribe meant like 26 people or something, you know. At that point, disease and other problems had reduced the tribes down to just a few dozen at the most. The Mohawk Band of Kalapuyans, which is in the sort of Mohawk Valley outside of Eugene, Marcolo area, right? I'm not gonna read this whole thing, but basically they create, in this line right here, it talks about them creating a reservation on the Scott Grant in that area. I think I have a slide with a picture. So I figured out it was in this area. If you look on the GLO maps, some people call them the GLO maps, of the what's called the Mohawk River outside of Marcola. There's the Scott land right there, and that's where the reservation was somehow. And that's what it looks like present day. So there was a small Kalapuya reservation there of about a few dozen people. There was also, near there, there was another band of the Kalapuyas called the Chiffin Band, or Chaffin Band. And they were on the Jacob Spohr's land claim, and this is an interesting one, because it says, commencing at a stake on the small creek in the prairie in which the Indian village is situated on Jacob Spohr's land claim. So that line directly suggests that there was a native village on his land claim. So he claimed land, which included a native village already. And so he basically made Jacob Spohr's the special agent in charge of that tribe that was already on his land. So I figured out where that was, because I can do that stuff. So there is the Jacob Spohr's DLC. I kind of drew it from based on the GLO maps and today's like Google Maps online. And somewhere in that area, probably between the river and the center point of his land, in that sort of pinkish area right now, was an Indian village and reservation. So that information could be used at some point in the future for archaeologists to look for that, because there's likely to be Indian cemeteries there and everything else. Although this area has been sort of heavily developed, I think if there's some It looks like there's some industrial development out there and some farming, so we don't know what's left. But Spores was a very early settler in that area, perhaps the earliest. And the bridge right there is named after him. It's the Spores Bridge. And so it's a pretty prominent property. And then another big one is the Chamafo Band of Kalapuyas, which we don't hear much about. They're a much smaller tribe. There are, again, a few dozen people remaining. But this is up near the town of Alpine on the west side of the valley. So on the Jacob Hammer allotment. So they're supposed to reside upon an enclosed and cultivated field of fields on the following portions of my land, be in the northwest corner of my claim, hence south to the creek, hence down south the creek to the alder grove, so hence to directly north. So that's the description. And, you know, we would have to do like river studies to figure out where it's meandered over the time to figure out exactly where that was, but clearly it's kind of near the river. And so the Chamafo Band, that's sort of called the Muddy Creek Band, would be moved there and stayed there for at least 10 months. And so that's kind of where it would be. There's a river that meanders through his property right there. There's the Hammer DLC. And so on the sort of western side of his property up near Alpine would have been somewhere in there would have been the reservation. And again, it's only a 10-month reservation. But these were planned to be upwards of 4 years. That was originally what was discussed. Palmer didn't realize by 1856 he'd have to suddenly move everybody at once to the Grand Army Reservation to get rid of possibility of more violence. Another village I found is that of the Halos, the Halo family, or also called the Halo Band of Kalapuyas in the south. This is Chief Halo, a couple pictures of him. Looked like kind of a small guy. But his last name, he took the name Fern, and that's becomes a pretty prominent family in that valley, in sort of the southern Willamette Valley and northern and in the Umpqua Valley. So I found on the GLO maps again this notation about the Chief Halo Tooth Indian town. So it's somewhat off of the river right there. On the Rao River down near Cottage Grove. And that's before you get to the reservoir that's there today. So I think the covered bridge is over here somewhere. But it looks like it's on a rise, which is what this is one of the evidence I'm using to say that the tribes didn't have villages right on the river. They actually were off the river on a risen area so they could stay away from the flood zone. And if they were seen situated on the rivers by explorers or whoever, I think those river settlements were like temporary summer settlements. They would set up a temporary encampment in the summertime on the river so they could have more ready access to the river. And then in the wintertime, they would go live in their winter houses on a rise, on a hillside. So this is in the Willamette Valley, and later on, because of settlement, he moves over to the village in Yoncalla, Oregon, near the Applegate Ranch. And so they're hosted by the Applegates through settlement, through colonization of the area, and the Applegates stop the removal of the Halos to Grand Ronde. The Halo clan says we basically don't want to move, and the agent brought a gun to sort of force them to move, and then apparently the Applegate stood in front of that and said we'll host them here and you can't take them. So, which is one of the few examples where non-natives stood up for natives in Oregon history. So removals happened really from 1856. And then I'm finding they continue to happen into the 1870s. And this seems strange, right? So, but it's true. I mean, about 95% of the people were removed in 1856 to either Grand Ronde or the Coast Reservation. I'm talking about Western Oregon. And then there were a number of scattered tribes that still were being removed from either the coast or the hills or from the Willamette Valley or the places on the Columbia up into the 1870s. Tribes in the south, like all the way down to the Chetco area of the southern coast by Brookings, were attacked a number of times by settlers and entrepreneurs that were trying to start port towns on the coast so they could, you know, make rich off the gold trade. And because of those attacks that were happening on their villages, they hid themselves in the coast range and would not come out when removal came along. So there were these people that were hired, sort of contractors that were hired to go down there and capture them and bring them to the reservation. I call them Indian catchers. And when I heard about that history, I started unveiling that history. I immediately thought of that evil guy in Chitty Chitty Bang Bang that kind of captures the children, put them in cages, you know. I don't know, it's my own crazy thing. So, but they're all people removed to Grand Ronde. Initially, the majority of tribes moved to Grand Ronde as sort of a temporary place to keep people until they're supposed to move to the Coast Reservation. And about a third people moved to the Coast Reservation. But by 1857, Sillette's agency had been built because there was nothing there before. There was no roads or anything. So by 1857, a good number of people moved over from Grand Ronde to Sillette's. And people from the coast moved out to Sillette's agency, and tribes began being moved up the coast. So the coast reservation became the reservation for mainly folks from the south, the Rogue Rivers, and folks from the coast, or the southern coast really, to the central coast. And Grand Ronde got most of the people from the valley and from the Columbia. And so there's other stuff to go with all that. But so this became this is in the full Grand Ronde Reservation. This became what became the Grand Ronde Reservation. They put a lot of time and effort into buying up the property here, to building up sort of the farms. And so the government decided to keep it as a reservation. So that's why Grand Ronde stayed around, and everybody wasn't just moved over to the coast. And there were already farms in place. Those farm agricultural plots were actually in place when they moved there. The government just bought out the Americans, and they moved on somewhere else. And there was a good set of roads that went to the reservation, to the valley, to the Central Valley from north. And this is that red line is the what's called the Salmon River Wagon Road, which today is the Salmon River Highway. Which is kind of a different location today. Today it goes like straight across the valley, but back then it kind of cruised up around the north. And that was a good wagon road that went to Salem. So that's why Grand Ronde was a preferential location for another reservation, because there was already good supply routes. The coast for the longest time, for at least 20 years or something, didn't have really good supply routes. You could bring boats there and stuff, but you couldn't land safely in the Sluts River. They went into the Aquinnah, and so taking supplies by boat was the only way to really get supplies there, because there was no roads. Or there was one really bad road that went over from like Corvallis to Sluts, and it was really, really bad. And it's legendary how bad that muddy road was. So Grand Ronde became the preferential place for most of the inland tribes. I also want to point out that, like I'm talking about, like there was like 20 years of removals of tribes, but still Native people were not absent from the valley. People did still get passes and move around the valley to things. I found records of Native people going to, this is a picture from Eugene, and this is a stick game between Grand Ronde and Sluts people and Eugene in the 1870s. And those pictures, that picture on the corner over there is Warm Springs children in a in a labor camp outside of Springfield, Oregon, and their parents are there probably to do some harvesting of vegetables and stuff. That was pretty common. Same thing here, and then another sort of hop laborers down the bottom. So tribal people would still leave the reservations to join sort of the workforce and help sort of harvest vegetables, at least in the valley in the summer times, and that became an annual pattern from the 1850s on, where people would stay on the reservation for the winter time, and then in the spring they would get these passes and leave and go into the valley and travel around and harvest vegetables through the summertime, and then come back at the end of the summer and then harvest their hay or something on their property, because the land they ran around was pretty bad, so all you could really grow is hay and make money on it. People had some small gardens, but it was not that great. You couldn't really grow food there for many years. So they became this sort of different pattern, different like agricultural pattern, which approximated the original, what we call seasonal round that they had lived in before, where they had a winter village and then traveled around in various places and gathered things and brought that food back to their winter village. So their winter village became the reservation, and they would travel around the Willamette Valley and harvest like hops and beans and berries and other stuff, and then make money doing that as whole families, and then we come back to the reservation at the end of the summer or the fall, and then rejoin people at the reservation. So that became an annual pattern that went on and really into the 1950s. And some families I've talked to say they were still doing it in the 1970s. Even though they were no longer on the reservation ground, it had been terminated, there's still some people that took it. That was a summer job. And I think I caught the tail end of that. When I was in the 1970s and 80s, when I was a kid, I went on the berry buses, right out of school, and literally the day after high school ended, or whatever, and you were at least like, I think you had to be 15 at least, you could jump on a berry bus and go out to the fields and pick berries, like strawberries, and then you were gone in like 10 hours, then you come back, and you were all exhausted and sunburnt and that kind of stuff. So. And for years afterwards, I couldn't eat strawberries because I had gorged myself in strawberries in the field because I was too lazy to make a lunch, So I'm like this kid. I don't want to make a lunch. I'm just going to go eat strawberries. So even today, I really don't like strawberries that much unless they're fresh. I don't know. So I caught the tail end of that, and I think that those berry bus years, I don't know, went on for some 20 years or something, probably had to be created as another workforce because Indian labor stopped in like the 1950s as a regular force you can count on when tribes got terminated in the West and stuff. So that's kind of part of my forced removal story. I mean, there's probably more to be said, but that's enough for now, right? There'll be a quiz later on, so. So yeah, back in 2004, I was actually at the University of Oregon, working on my PhD program. And I think there was a request for me to consult on their exhibit. And I did a speaking engagement too. And so I felt empowered at that point to sort of give feedback, and that's kind of where the letter comes from. It'd be interesting to see what I said.
I'll give it to you.
But I know I was kind of unvarnished in my comments at that time, and I didn't really worry so much about the sympathies of the people who ascribed to sort of pioneer mythologies and stuff, and because it's all our history, it's not just the pioneer history. So when we talk about the history of Oregon, what I saw it is more of a global perspective. There were not just pioneers in Oregon at the time. There were a lot of other peoples, including a whole bunch of Native people. And, since that time, I've had additional thoughts about, the blacks in Oregon, Latinos in Oregon, Japanese, Chinese, other peoples who came to Oregon really kind of to help with the colonization of this place and helping the pioneers to develop their farms, develop their businesses, to create that wealth they were looking for. And in almost all cases, the histories have given that overall context almost no thought. It's only about the pioneers and the great stuff they did, as opposed to the things they did to other people while they were doing that great stuff, and the people that helped them in the process, including those people they were actually impacting. There's a whole history, which I'm kind of starting to uncover, which is hard to uncover because it takes a lot of work going through archives and whatnot, to finding out how much the Native people actually helped these people who were called the pioneers build their farms and things. I found, just for one example, editorials in the papers in the area, like the Oregonian, talking about how the tribes in this valley, the Tualatin peoples, are already well versed in farming and agriculture, and because they've been helping for some 15 years or so these settlers develop their farms. I mean, when you think about that, that's not the story you ever hear, right? At all. And I never heard that story anywhere in Oregon until I started uncovering it. I mean, there were some sort of hints of it in some of the histories, but there wasn't really addressed in any kind of real way. And so, and you start thinking about the context of settlers coming into Oregon. The donation land claims were how many acres? 640 acres. That's a mile square piece of land. And if you have a family of, you know, 4 to 8 people, a lot of families had lots of kids, you know, they still would not have the manpower, literally, or women power, whatever you call it, to develop a mile square piece of land. So they would have to, if they're putting in fences, they would have to get help from other people, building barns, building the farmhouse, plowing the fields, all the stuff that you needed to have a farm. You would have to have help, either from other farmers or from Native people, which is what they did. They hired Natives on a kind of a day labor basis to, you know, usually by trade, giving them some food or some of the cool things they had, you know, the stuff they brought, like metals and guns and whatnot, and traded those things for the labor of the tribes to help them sort of build their farms. And at that time, the tribes really didn't think about anything like, we're going to lose all of our land, we're going to have to assimilate, all that stuff. All they were really thinking about was, these people brought all this really cool, wealthy stuff, and we want some of it because it helps, you know, us live our lives better. Guns are better for hunting. Metals, you know, knives are better. Metal knives are better than sort of stone knives or obsidian knives. So all those things are better for us. We like that stuff. It's wealth items. We want that wealth because tribes in the area are all about wealth. And they wanted their kids and themselves to sort of learn that new culture coming along so they could survive. And that's perhaps different even than the stories we're hearing today, where people are upset about colonization. They're saying colonization caused all this stuff. But that's not the context of the tribes back in the day. It wasn't until the 1850s or so that, and there were treaties and forced removals, that tribes really thought that, you know, something horrible had happened. And they were talking about it too. That's also something not addressed. There are actually transcriptions of the tribes talking about how they knew they had thrown everything away. And they couldn't do anything about it now, so they had to do what they could to sell their land and survive as they can. And so that is some of the stuff that I'd like to bring out as, you know, tribal people is not just passive recipients of what was happening, but actively engaged with and thinking about that stuff and being sort of human in that process, you know? Because otherwise, I think that if you constantly are talking about tribal people as being sort of these passive recipients of the violence, they're not. That's dehumanizing them in some way. They have some intentionality about it. They knew what they were doing for a while. They saw it happening. They had thoughts about that, and they were they became upset eventually about that. So, and that's something that really needs to be told in our history. That's Oregon history too, as well as that, all that settler and pioneer history as well. And I understand, you know, the need to why pioneer history was so valuable. Many of you are descendants of these pioneers, and it's engaging to think that your parents and grandparents and great-grandparents and I don't know how many times removed parents did something great. That's really an engaging thought, you know, and it doesn't feel good to think that maybe your ancestors did something not so great. And I understand that. You know, the thing that tribes need to understand, tribal people need to understand as well, and admit, is that many of us are actually descendants of those people as well. We have this sort of dual ancestry, right? Many of us are tribal, as well as being the descendants of people who moved here to immigrate here and for greater wealth or whatever. So, and that's part of our legacy as well. So we are, in a sense, descendants of both of those cultures. So, and we go both ways. We, you know, we think about that both ways sometimes. I mean, it's hard for me to deny that sort of settlered pioneer past I have. And I think that's, you know, our collective sort of responsibility to admit that and to not avoid the difficult conversations. And these are difficult conversations. I mean, I teach about this stuff all the time, and I have students who in many ways are engaging with this kind of a story, narrative, for the first time, because they're not exposed to it in grade school in Oregon, for the most part. And so it's really strange for them to be coming into college and for the first time hearing that there was, you know, genocide in Oregon and that the native view of history is not exactly the same as what they learned in high school. And my kid, I have a kid who just graduated high school, and he's now going on to college at Chemeketa. And I just as he was graduating, I was thinking, there's a whole bunch of stuff he needs to unlearn now. You know, it's like, it's hard to get out. It's a system that, you know, is somehow inculcated in sort of our education system, and it's really hard for us to do anything about that right now. It takes 20 or 30 years to turn that ship, you know. It's tough. And even my kids, even though I have quite a bit of knowledge about this stuff, and all our kids perhaps, you know, have to go through that system still, and we still have to sort of retrain them when they are ready to do that, because they're not ready, you know. My kids are like teenagers, are like, Dad, you're the stupidest person in the world, you know, that kind of stuff. And so, that's just one of those things, you know. And then a couple of years from now, they'll have kids and I'll be the smartest person in the world. That's right. When I can babysit, they'll be like, he's smart. So I guess what I've been doing for a while now, and it's kind of cool to see I've been pretty consistent, you know, for yeah, like 20 years, 15, 20 years, you know. What I've been doing is looking at those difficult areas to look at. I mean, they're difficult. I mean, the idea that you're forcing children to go to a boarding school, and then you're sort of really assimilating them in the sense of changing their culture in a forced way. And that's a difficult story. I mean, the first time I was really exposed to it as a truly difficult story was when my wife was doing research also at U of O, and she was, you know, in sociology, and she had looking for a project, and she started looking at forced sterilization, right? Mm-hmm. And so, and there was a little bit of research in the 90s and perhaps a little bit earlier about forced sterilization of Native American women. And she sort of linked it up with you know, white supremacy and stuff like that. And there was all these efforts in the U.S. government to, in a sense, sterilize these people that are in certain categories, like prisoners, mentally ill, and Native people, and then immigrants too. A lot of immigrants were forced into sort of sterilization because they didn't know any better and they were told by their doctors they had to. And so, but she came out with this amazing paper, you know, much more amazing than anything I've done so far, you know, seriously. I actually offer it in my classes and people are like, whoa, you know. And so, but about how there was this enforced sterilization of Native American women in the boarding schools. So those boarding schools take on a whole different connotation at that point. And then that raised a lot of, you know, ideas in my own about what else what they were doing in the boarding schools. So I began questioning that pretty broad way. And this idea that they're forcing that cultural change and is not just cultural change, it's something else. Something else is going on there, something really horrible. And so you're ruining people's identity. And then at the latter stages, which is not that long ago, we're talking early 1970s, it was still going on. So we're not talking about, you know, for us in the room, that's not that long ago, right? Sure. Right, so the first education efforts in the state were through like Jason Lee's Methodist, you know, mission in the Valley in the 1830s and then into the 1840s where they basically brought children in from called the Willamette Plains, and they started like to assimilate them, give them American names, teach them how to do agriculture, and teach them in sort of this Western civilization type educational program. And then after that, that was sort of adopted by this sort of idea of a mission school was adopted by the U.S. government as the plan about the way to go. And so so at the reservations from 1856 on, tribes got these sort of schools, and schools were essentially a room with a big table and all the students sat around the table. And for the first 15 years or so, and I haven't figured out exactly how long, but the first at least 15 years, the schools were run by whatever church was assigned to that reservation. And actually this was an assigned thing. I mean, the U.S. government assigned one church to be the sort of predominant church on that reservation and didn't allow any other churches to come on. And so there was a division between Methodists, other Protestants, and Catholics. And so we saw, you know, Grand Ronde got a Catholic church and Siletz got a Methodist church. So, I mean, that's like that. So for the first few years, I mean, that was run by the Catholic priest at Grand Ronde, and then brought in Order of Sisters to run the school. They actually did the work. He was basically in control of all that. And then after a while, the U.S. government started to hire other educators and take control of the schools. And by the time there was boarding schools in the 1880s, that was pretty much run by the government at that point. And so at the reservation, we'd have these two schools, day schools, which were schools that kids would go to, again, just like your public school today, like during the day. And then they began to have these boarding schools at the same time. So there's at least two or three schools at the reservation at any one time, kind of funded by the treaties for the first 20 years. And at the boarding schools, the kids were literally living in those schools from the age of six and on. And they're just removed from their families and they can't go back home when you're in the boarding school. And that's the next sort of level of assimilation, because they've realized that the day schools were not assimilating kids fast enough. So that people were not unlearning their culture, they were still like speaking their languages, they were still, and then the parents would a lot of times keep their kids out of school because they needed their help around, you know, the house or a farm or hunting or whatever. So back that time you needed like everybody to help, otherwise you're gonna starve. So they found that boarding schools were more effective, and then it became cost prohibitive. And they realized they needed to have a cheaper way of doing it, so they decided to do these sort of area boarding schools where they'd attract tribes from many areas to that one school. And that became the predominant schooling system for across the United States. There were hundreds of boarding schools. So the first one in Oregon, besides at Grand Ronde, and various tribes had boarding schools, the first one off reservation was Forest Grove. for 5 years. Then one of the buildings burned down, and they moved it over to Chamawa area. And from there, they bought land, really off the students' efforts. The students were literally went out and worked for farmers in the Lake Labish area, because that's where the school is. And the money they made, they would take from them. I don't know if it was a contract basis or what was going on, but the money was used to buy more land for the school. So now the tribes in Oregon are and the state of Oregon are in this like conversation about who actually owns that school. Is it really a federal school if the money was taken from the kids to buy much of the land? And so right now the state of Oregon technically owns the land, or is it really owned somehow jointly by the tribes? And that's a conversation that may continue for some time, because there's a much more enhanced scrutiny over Chamao and their education practices. That's pretty much the context. I mean, what happened in the schools seems pretty dramatic. I mean, kids were taught mainly to do what we now call blue-collar labor jobs. You know, do agriculture, animal husbandry, carpentry, painting. Women were taught how to, you know, clean and wash things, you know, and women's things. Absolutely, right. Sewing, you know.
So you can see that.
Sewing, cooking, I mean, that's the direction. And other scholars have noted that at the time when boarding schools had begun and were sort of operating under that model, and I don't think that model really ended until the 1970s, but we're beginning to operate under that model. Even at that time, they're training many of the kids, the boys at least, to be farmers, and farming as a way to sort of make a living in the United States was going under, was not working. And a lot of small farmers, even American farmers, were selling their land. And so the only way to sort of make any kind of money or sort of make a living at a farm would be to acquire more and more land and get much larger farms. So what they were training the kids to do was something that would be undervalued when they got out of school. Yeah, about the religious beliefs, I mean, it was the case that it was kind of forced by the agents early on. There's various periods where the agents are addressing certain beliefs, like early on they began to address polygamy, because it was pretty common among the tribes for like chiefs and stuff to have like several wives. So they began addressing that, then they began addressing health care or medical care. They wanted them to see white doctors, and there was a taboo against that among many tribal members. And they wanted to make sure they would put their kids in education. And so there were these conversations all along to try to get the people to give up parts of their culture and to sort of give up their reliance upon, you know, the native, what they call Indian doctors then, as religious leaders, and they became less and less powerful over time. In some areas, they, like in Canada and stuff, they burned longhouses and stuff just to get rid of things like the potlatch and things like that, which is a giveaway ceremony. And so there was this enforced, but you know, really, we really have to think about this in terms of who they were as Native people. At that time, up until 1924, Native people in the United States, unless they had sort of served in the army or had gotten citizenship some other way, were not citizens of the United States, they're not Americans. So they were almost treated as if they were immigrants. And in many ways, immigrants had more power, had more ability to integrate into society than Native people. And so they were treated like immigrants, as if they didn't really belong here, as if the land really wasn't theirs, as if they hadn't lived here for 10,000 years. You know, it's a very strange situation. And you're right, they could not leave the reservations because they were not allowed to by federal policy. And they had to have a note if they wanted to go somewhere. Literally. And so they were literally these passes, these notes written by agents to allow families to go sort of fish somewhere or hunt. And there were agreements between some farmers and some native people to go work on their farms, even live on the farms at times. But it had to be all approved by the U.S. government. But it wasn't until 1924 that where there was a Citizenship Act that Native people became citizens of the United States, which is very strange. You think that if you wanted people to assimilate, the first thing you do is give them citizenship, not hold it up as some sort of a carrot, you know, that they have to sort of, but that's what they did, you know, under U.S. Grant, President U.S. Grant, he said, if they can be civilized, then we'll make them citizens. So they're held up as this carrot, you know. Civilization is the carrot to become citizens of the United States. And nobody knew what that meant. I mean, the BIA was like, okay, we'll give them land now. So, and that was really strange because, you know, 15 years earlier, they had already promised them land, never given them land in the treaties. Suddenly now they get a piece of land. And within 10 years at Grand Ronde, they are self-supporting because they had learned in the first almost 20 years that you could not trust the government to help you. And if you did, you're going to starve and die. So, I mean, all this stuff, it becomes all mixed together, all these ideas, the concepts. And this is the fine detail about the tribes, about the context of the tribes in Oregon that we just don't know, that most people Oregonians don't know, because that was all ignored by historians. Nobody knew it. The reservations were federally controlled. The state had no context there. And in fact, it wasn't until 1952 the state began to take some ownership over things on the reservations when termination came around. But before that, it was like, we don't know any of these people. We have no jurisdiction over the reservations. And so there's a lot of structural problems there that need to be overcome before natives become full-fledged Americans. And those structural problems sometimes still exist. And we're still kind of dealing with that. This idea that history as written is not dealing with this context is one of those structural problems. Well, about termination, so, I mean, I did my whole dissertation on this, so there's a lot more to be said, but basically the federal government decided that in the 1940s, during and after World War II, that they needed to sort of somehow find a way to save money. They put a lot of development into the Army. It had grown some 2,000%, and we're still occupying, like, Europe and Japan. So they need to find a way to save money, so they decided to go after these smaller programs like Indian Affairs, and they decided on this program of liquidation. And the first thought was liquidation. We're going to liquidate the assets of the reservation, and we're going to sort of save money that way. It became termination. It became this idea that we'll terminate, because you couldn't just liquidate them. The tribes have agreements under treaties. So you have to somehow get rid of the treaties, so they became terminating the agreements, the treaties, so the tribes could no longer claim rights under U.S. law. And so over a period of some 10 years from, or actually, yeah, 10 years from 1944 to 1954, the federal government began working on this idea of termination, talking to the tribes, getting them to agree a few things, proposing bills, getting them to review the bills. And it turns out that none of the tribes in Oregon ever really agreed to termination that I could find. That there were a lot of proposals, they were reviewing things. They made a lot of movements towards looking like they might agree, like beginning to turn over federal, like sovereign affairs to the state. There was a bill called PL 280. Which allows state law to apply to reservations, which then eliminates that sovereign immunity on reservations for some things like civil penalties and criminal penalties and things like that, because that was all federal before. they began turning over some other sovereign stuff to the federal government and saying that basically it's inevitable and being sold on this idea that, well, you know, it would be better if you were first-class citizens, that you were not on a reservation and you were not living under the dole or the welfare of the federal government, and you, there would no longer be discrimination, which, you know, we know it doesn't work, but that doesn't just happen. So so there would be no longer discrimination, be first-class citizens. And so they were sold that idea, and they were all, and the first deal was, well, you'd have control of your own land. We'll give you your land, and you no longer have us looking over your shoulder. You no longer be like Indians with a treaty, but you would be first-class citizens, and you keep your land. So that bill was approved by the tribe. That early was called early termination bill, but when it went to Congress, Congress said, "Wait a minute, you know, we own that land. The title of all that land is under federal trust. That means the federal government owns it all. So we're not going to just give you all that land. You have to buy it." So it's an ironic laugh, isn't it? So they sent another bill, and they said, "Well, you can be released if you buy your land." And the tribes reneged on that. They said, "Well, we want to approve this. There's a lot of other issues and stuff. We need you to pay over our Indian claims cases that were pending. We need all this stuff to happen." You never see any documented source that says they agreed to termination. But the agents sort of forced it through Congress, saying they agreed in principle. And he presented the final termination bill in 1954 with the earlier agreements from the earlier agreement. And so it's very clear they lied. So Congress terminated the Western Oregon Indian tribes, including Siletz, Grand Ronde. And if you look at the preamble, all the tribes in Western Oregon, which equals some 60 tribes. So that's kind of what happened. And so the tribes were kind of released. And I think the payoff was $35 a person. So that's the pay they got for whatever land was left at the reservation, whatever property was left. The government, I looked at some of the accounting, because there's National Archives has like everything, and so I looked at the accounting forms, and they were charging towards that ultimate, you know, payoff, things like the GI fatigue material and stuff from World War II, because when the war was over, they had all this like fabric, and so they supposedly gave it or donated it to the reservation, but they were charged it under termination. I mean, there's some really petty stuff, you know. And for 100 years living inside the United States, the tribes basically got, Grand Ronde at least got $35. For Siletz, they got upwards of $2,000 or more dollars a piece because they had more land left over by that time. We only had not even 600 acres left from the original 60,000 acre reservation. So that's pretty much the story. I mean, the tribes basically lost everything, went down to no land. Like in 100 years from signing treaties to termination, they end up with no land. And being in a very racist environment against Indians, not knowing how every system works, like things like taxes and stuff. A lot of tribes never dealt with taxes before. And so they all kind of had to move to cities and find jobs. And at that point, there was a huge effect on, you know, languages, like native languages and culture. There was no longer any tribal center, so there's no place to base your culture on. And so there was huge effects on culture and language, and people like just didn't know who their families were anymore. There was no longer passing on that information to the next generation. And so we see some families kept it together, but a lot of families didn't. And we see people today coming back to the reservation and finding out they have this sort of genealogical connection and not really knowing who they are, you know. They just like, I don't know who I am, where I come from. And that's not an odd thing to say. It happens all the time because it went on for generations. So termination went on for generations. We were terminated from the final termination bill of 1956, and we were restored in 1983. So several generations in there, and many, many people just don't know who they are, you know, and many others who somewhat know who they are don't care that much about the history. So, and it's not surprising then that the rest of the Oregonians don't know anything about our history either, because if tribal people don't know about their history, you know, who's going to tell them?